This week, Howard Sattler exclusively interviewed WA Police Union President about a new campaign by his members for workers' compensation coverage.
The government and WA Police have responsibility to look after officers who are retired medically unfit.
Animal and shark advocates relieved as drumlines are being taken out of the water.
And the aerial search for missing flight MH370 has officially ended.
This is the Evening News with Ivan Leung and Daniel Staniskov.
Good evening. Almost 5 years after 5,000 of the members rallied on the steps of State Parliament House in Perth, WA Police are about to embark on a new campaign for workers' compensation entitlements. Little has changed since that unprecedented public protest, while serving officers in the most dangerous government sector, excluded from most of the benefits available to other public servants who are injured or fall ill on the job. Howard Sattler, who was the MC at the 2009 rally, takes up the issue with WA Branch President George Tilbury.
I hosted a rally of about 5,000 officers on the steps of State Parliament. That was almost 5 years ago, calling for police to be covered by workers' comp. What's happened since then?
Nothing at all has changed in relation to workers' compensation. We're currently working on Project Recompense and doing a lot of research, but we will be launching something at our conference in November this year.
But how can nothing have happened in 5 years?
A lot of work needs to be done, but the government and WA Police have responsibility to look after officers who are retired medically unfit.
What's that mean? How does it actually affect police officers in getting into trouble with their health and things like that?
What we're seeing at the moment is that police officers, particularly those that are injured on duty, if they're retired medically unfit, they don't get any compensation whatsoever.
I heard a harrowing story. A police officer in New South Wales, I think it was, called Triple O just before he killed himself. Police officers here suiciding as a result of the situation or not?
I'm not sure of the actual statistics, and we don't know if it's directly attributed to that, but we do have similar sorts of instances in this state, which is terrible.
Police officers actually killing themselves because they can't cope. Serving officers or people who've retired?
There's been a combination over the years, and one loss of life is one too many, and something needs to be done to stop that from happening.
Are there any signs that support services are improving here?
Health and welfare have improved within WA Police, but there's still a long way to go, and we call on government and the agency to provide better services for our members.
What about the hierarchy of the police force, the commissioner and his other officer? Are they going to bat for you? Because there are a number of them over that rally we talked about.
Commissioner O'Callaghan, who I've spoken to about this matter, has actually publicly come out and said it's not fair, it's not good enough, and something needs to change.
This comes right to the quick, George. Now, are your members prepared to even go on strike over this issue? I would think that if anything, it would justify it.
Police officers can't strike, but we would certainly be wanting to take whatever action we had to make sure that some system that is fair and reasonable is introduced for our members.
Thanks for your time, George.
No worries, Howard.
Anti-shark colour activists in Western Australia celebrated the removal of drumlines as the trial finished this week. Martin Wilson reports.
Approximately 60 people gathered at Cottesloe Beach this week to celebrate the end of the drumline policy. During the trial, more than 33 sharks over 3 metres were killed, with another 12 sharks also dying in the drumline. President of Sea Chef Australia, Jeff Hansen, said the drumline program did not work and he did not wish to see the program continue.
What's most concerning about this is, one, we know it doesn't work. You know, we know we've seen there's so many great alternatives out there to this drumline program. In Cape Town, they use the Shark Spotters program, and in amongst the surfing communities that we've spoken to, that's a solution that the local people are really interested in.
Labor opposition spokesman Chris Talentire, Animal Justice Party's Katrina Love, activist Natalie Banks, and various other participants also fronted the media. Most participants expressed their frustrations over the government's shark cull policy and vowed to restart their campaigns if the drumlines came back into the water. Martin Wilson, WAMN News.
West Australian public servants are considering a 24-hour strike in a bid to secure a fairer pay deal. The union's demanding the government to put an offer on the table. Kierath Taplin has more.
Members of the CPSU-CSA are considering industrial action if the government does not raise the wages of public servants. The last time the union strikes was over a decade ago, but they are getting set to walk off the job on the 28th of May for 24 hours if the government does not increase their wage offer. The offer currently stands at 2.5%, but the CPI figure, which was released last week, was 3.1%. CPSU CSA branch secretary Tony Walkington believes the government is being arrogant for not providing an offer which meets the cost of living while also cutting jobs.
We're not asking for a big pay increase. We're asking for the government to respond to what they say their intention is, which is to keep the cost of living within the reach of their government workers. They're not doing that.
The union is encouraging its members to cast their ballots between the 5th and 19th of May to come to a conclusion on whether or not the industrial strike should go ahead. Kira Taplin, WAMM News.
Former WA Treasurer and Transport Minister Troy Buswell was fined $3,100 and his driver's licence suspended for 12 months after the driving incident which cost him his ministerial career. The opposition is demanding an explanation from Mr. Buswell.
Numerous witnesses saw Mr. Buswell drinking at the event. We then know he drove and smashed into a bunch of vehicles. We know a witness saw him in a dishevelled state. He needs to come out and be honest and open and accountable, and the Premier should not be making any excuses for him.
To World News, BBC Top Gear host Jeremy Clarkson has apologised for using a racist term during the pre-recording of the show several years ago. In a statement, Mr. Clarkson said he was horrified by the word he has used and he did everything in his power to make sure that version did not go to air.
In fact, I have here the note I sent at the time to the production office, and it says, "I didn't use the N-word here, but I've just listened through my headphones and it sounds like I did. Is there another take that we could use? Please be assured I did everything in my power to not use that word, and that I'm sitting here begging your forgiveness for the fact that obviously my efforts weren't quite good enough."
Malaysian authorities released a report on the disappearance of missing flight MH370. This comes after the aerial search for the plane wreckage on the surface of the Indian Ocean has finally ended. Zarif Alibhai reports.
7 weeks after the disappearance of Malaysian airline flight MH370, the Malaysian government released a report revealing more details about what happened. It indicated there was confusion between Malaysian and regional air traffic controllers on where they lost contact with the plane. According to the report, it took Malaysian authorities 4 hours to launch the search at the South China Sea where they had the last contact with the plane. The report also failed to give new information about what happened in cockpit after the flight moved away from its path to Beijing. Meanwhile, the intensive air search for MH370's plane wreckage has officially ended this week. Zarif Alibhai, WAM News.
And here's Cahli Samata with this week's top stories in science.
Thanks, Ivan and Danielle. Sonar tests off the coast of Shark Bay have proved successful in detecting sharks. Marine scientists detected tiger sharks, bronze whalers, bull sharks, and grey reef sharks by attaching an acoustic sonar device to a boat. The goal of the project, led by Curtin researcher Miles Parsons, is to develop a beach protection system which can alert authorities to sharks that may pose a risk to swimmers. Two grasshopper species have been found to modify their escape strategies when repeatedly approached by a predator. The study by Curtin's Bill Bateman and Murdoch's Trish Fleming challenged the traditional belief that animals have a single fleeing response by testing whether the grasshoppers could modify their escape strategies according to their situation. The study found that in response to persistent pursuit, the two species would switch to a Plan B, which included potentially riskier tactics. Groundbreaking research at the University of Western Australia has found that engaging in the arts for recreation, entertainment, or as a hobby can be good for your mental, social, and physical well-being. Activities such as painting, dancing, and creative writing could make a difference to the health of individuals and the community. Lead author Christina Davies said that in the award-winning study, arts engagement was found to make people feel happy, reduce their stress, and resulted in the creation of good memories. And that's science.
Thank you, Cahli. And that's the program for this week. You can hop onto our website, Facebook and Twitter for the latest news.
Thanks for watching. We'll see you again next Sunday.
Good night.